So I finally got around to testing the RTX 40 series GPUs for video editing performance. I've got the ROG Strix 4080 here and the Tough Gaming 4090. And I compared them against my current 3090 and 3090 Ti cards. Now, these cards were provided to me by Asus. This video is not sponsored, but I might talk about some of the cooler features about these cards as sort of a thank you for them sending them over. And I'm going to be doing most of these tests on DaVinci Resolve, primarily because that's what I use. But I also think that when it comes to expensive GPUs like these, that if you're going to buy these cards, you're probably better off using DaVinci Resolve, again, personal opinion, because that NLE leverages your hardware much better than any other NLEs, including Premiere Pro. So I'm not saying you can't use Premiere Pro and use these graphics cards. Obviously you can, and you can get some great results out of them. But in my opinion, Resolve is the best use case for getting the maximum value out of the dollars spent on your GPU, unless we include gaming, which we're not in this video. But for an even deeper disclosure, the reason why I like to do these top-of-the-line GPU video editing performance roundup videos is to convince the partner board companies to send them over to me so it's applicable to my audience, so I can make a video about them, so then afterwards, I can use them for my own personal gaming needs.
Foul tarnished.
But anyway, the recommendations I give on these cards will be related to video editing, and I actually am going to use them for that purpose moving forward. I've been using the RTX cards for quite a while now. But, yeah. I game with them on the side, and this is all part of a grand scheme to keep my gaming rig at its max potential. So first off, I averaged out a bunch of render tests. Now this was with like a 15-minute project, which was basically one of my camera reviews. So there's a lot of different, like there's footage from the camera, footage from the A-roll, tests, noise, you know, effects and stuff. Basically an entire 15-minute camera review. And then I exported it with all four graphics cards using the exact same settings, which I'm going to put up on the screen here, by the way. Now, I stand by these settings if you use H.264 and NVENC, because CQP numbers that I've dialed in here, which took a lot of time, give you almost like the best size to quality ratio. If you want like almost perfect quality at the lowest size you can get, this is a pretty good balance of that. But anyway, when running it through the 3090, it took 6 minutes and 29 seconds to export, and 6 minutes and 16 seconds on the 3090 Ti. So they're pretty similar. You're only getting a small uptick going to the Ti. But now with the 4080, it was 3 minutes and 30 seconds and 3 minutes and 38 seconds. It was, on average, it was a little bit longer on the 4090. But again, these two are about the same at 3.5 versus 6.5 on the previous gen. So that's considerable. Obviously, we're only talking about 3 minutes here. But on a bigger project, that's going to increase. And over multiple renders over weeks and months, this is going to add up, basically having your time spent on render. File size on all of them was exactly the same, which is important because sometimes generationally, like going from the 10 series, the 20 series, 20 series, the 30 series, file sizes can get smaller or change because they're using some sort of new system with NVENC. But going from 30 series to 40 series, the file size was the same for me. Now during those renders, the temperatures were interesting. So the hottest GPU was the 3090. Now, obviously, this is going to depend a little bit on, you know, which card you're using. But all of the ones that I had are like big three, like triple fan. They're all like really, really good coolers. So I think even though they're different models, like Tough and Strix, and I had another brand for the 3090 Ti. So 58 degrees was the max core temp when doing the render for the 3090. 55 for the 3090 Ti. And then only 52 on the 4080, and then only 44 on the 4090. I found that banging out this render real quick, like 3.5 minutes, the 4090 didn't even start to get up, like climb in temperature yet. It was still like barely, like its basic running temperature. It took more than just one render in order to get it kind of cooked up. So we did a benchmark afterwards to see how hot it would get. The max temp on the 3090 was 67. It was 64 on the 3090 Ti. 66 on the 4080, so it actually was a little bit hotter than the 3090 Ti, and then 64 again on the 4090. So similar results between the 4090 and the 3090 Ti. And then the average temperature, 47, 46, 38, and 35. So again, that's interesting. The previous generation just seemed to run hotter on average for me than the 40 series does, with the 4090 in particular being the coolest. But the memory temperatures is the biggest change here. Like all these temperatures are fine. They're all workable. But 96 degrees is a maximum memory temperature on the 3090, which there's been videos posted of like how you can fix this, but still 96 degrees, that's really, really hot when you compare it to the 68, 72, and 68 of the three cards. So regardless, I guess moving to any of these cards from the 3090, unless you want to do a repair job on the 3090 yourself, you will get a lower memory temperature. So that's good. I also looked at the power draw and total power consumption during these renders. Now, obviously, the time that it takes to render is going to affect this, because if we look at the 3090 and 3090 Ti, it was a total of 0.032 and 0.03 kilowatt hours to complete that render, because it took 6.5 minutes. And you can see the peak draw during that time was 520 watts on the 3090 and 495 watts on the 3090 Ti. If we look at the 4080 and 4090 instead, it was only 0.018 and 0.019 kilowatt hours to run the renders. But that's also because the renders only took half the time. So that makes sense. So, and also the peak draw was lower though, 397 watts on the 4080 and 427 watts on the 4090. So what I did is I let them render over and over and over again for an hour to see how much power consumption there'd be over that full hour. And for the 3090, it was 0.296 kilowatt hours, 0.287 for the 3090 Ti, 0.253 for the 4080, and 0.282 for the 4090. Now, one thing to note though is that on the 4090, you can underpower, like you can lower the power limit and potentially equalize the results between the 4090 and the 4080 in terms of power consumption, while still getting some advantages out of the 4090 if power consumption is your primary concern. So I ran the Puget Resolve benchmark. 3090, it got a total score of 2,113, and on the 3090 Ti, 2,137. Now, if you were just basing everything just on those two numbers, you would say, well, that's not really worth the upgrade, right? But obviously there's other factors, memory temperature, total power draw, gaming performance, other aspects of that. And then for the 4080, another slight bump over the 3090 Ti to 2177. But you could argue that the 4080 is somewhat comparable to the 3090 Ti of the previous generation, but it can accomplish that at a lower power consumption and also render in half the time. So that's a win for the 4080, but in general editing performance, you're probably going to see something similar to a 3090 Ti. But then the 4090 pulls out a clear win here with a score of 2483, and it's the only one that sort of showed like a noticeable uptick. And again, half the render time and, you know, about the same or slightly lower power consumption than the 3090 Ti. So that's a win for the 4090. I'll put the full results of this benchmark on the screen now so you can pause for each of the cards if you want to save it and compare or whatever. But if we take a closer look between a couple, we can see where you're going to see or feel some of the performance increases during editing. So right now, comparing the 4090 to the 3090 Ti, we can see that higher is better, by the way. This is basically how many frames per second it takes to complete the task. So doing an H.264 to H.264 on the 4090 was significantly better than something like the 3090 Ti. And then if we look down in the GPU effects section, we can see noticeable upticks in most of the GPU effects results. But then, you know, Fusion, probably not as big of a difference. So I would say that if you're running a lot of GPU effects on your footage as a process, or you're doing a lot of transcoding, you probably will notice a difference upgrading to the 40 series. But if we compare the 40 series cards, we're seeing the same advantages for the 4090, but now with a smaller margin. So the transcoding is still better on the 4090. And again, the GPU effects do still have better performance numbers, but much, much smaller margins, which makes us want to compare the 3090 Ti to the 4080. Even though the overall performance score was quite similar, we are seeing a decent performance uptick in transcoding again on the 40 series when comparing the 4080 to a 3090 Ti. But now the GPU effects aren't that big of a difference. I would say if that's primarily what you're looking to improve, you're probably not going to see a huge difference, except for optical flow was significantly better on the, like going from 24 frames per second to 36, 37 is a noticeable uptick there. Now, I wanted to talk about the actual physical cards a little bit because it was a different experience here. So I've got the Tough Gaming is the one that's currently in my editing rig. Let's unbox the 4080 because I wanted to talk about something with this card. Now, this is, I'm not trying to throw any shade on, you know, Asus in particular here. Jeez. By the way, these cards are significantly heavier than the 30 series. When I received the packages, I was like, yikes, what are these? Even comparing the box of the new Strix versus the 3090 Strix. And this is the 4080, the 3090 versus the 4080, and it's absurd. Okay, couple things. First off, this card is massive. And this is only the 4080, so I was scared because I opened this one first. And it's very, very heavy. But they do give you, Asus does anyway, this little trinket now that's magnetic, which is kind of cool on the bottom. It's magnetic. And then you can unscrew this, and there's this little... It's actually a screwdriver with a ruler on it. And, you know, you could put it in this way if you want to use a screwdriver. Or you can turn it around the way that it comes. And then you tighten this down, and it basically acts as a support. So you can, you know, use the magnetic gun in your case, and then I guess it would be installed this way. And then you would, you know, use this to kind of support your graphics card. It works. I have it working on 3090 now, and it's kind of novel, and I like how strong the magnet is. But that's indicative of just how big and heavy these cards are. Asus, this is sort of a request to you, especially compared to the Tough card. Why are there so many peelies on these Strix cards? Every single like little surface deckel has like a peely on it. I think I probably spent like 10 minutes just taking all the peelies off, and I was left with this giant wad. Can we cool it with that, or maybe just put like a big one over the whole card or something? To get this card in and sort of finagle it around things, I actually took the fan off the cooler here on the bottom to be able to like wiggle it in better. And then the other issue is that, you see how recessed the place where you screw this onto the back plate is? Because of this and because of how straight it is, and then where my chassis was, it was actually really hard to get a screwdriver to kind of like wiggle its way down in here and keep a good hold on the screw and then tighten it down to the case. Anyway, this card was hard to install. So I was scared moving to the 4090 because like, oh God, it's going to be even worse. But coincidentally, the Tough 4090 is actually smaller, more compact, and much easier to install. And for my personal taste, far fewer peelies because there's less RGB and less, you know, flashy bits. So if you want something that, you know, looks cool, is all colorful like this card, this is definitely the, you know, the flashier card if that's what you're into. But the Tough Gaming was much more toned down. I like the gray look. I've got a lot of, you know, gray aspects to my build currently. So this one fits my style a lot better. Fewer peelies, easy to install. No, not as much RGB. There's just the Tough logo that has RGB on it. So yeah, I personally, and the price difference between these two was surprisingly low. Here in Canada, I think this one's only like $100, $150 Canadian more than this card. There's a sweet spot in the value there between these based on the results that I've been recording, that if I were to, between what I tested, for instance, I would buy the 4090 Tough before I would buy the 4080 Strix for multiple reasons. So just sort of keep that in mind going into it. But to be honest, the margins between these cards for most video editing applications, you know, are quite small. I would say the differences are quite minor. That being said, there was a noticeable jump going to the 4090, but these cards these days are really expensive. So that's why I'm saying I hope that, you know, you're either using this for business, you're making money on it for video editing or whatever, or at least you're hopefully getting some other applications out of it as well, like gaming and that kind of thing. Yeah, like I said, though, what are you doing? You're getting these RTX 40 series cards for video editing and you're not gaming? Come on! Gotta increase your value. Anyway, I don't know how to end this video. I hope this information was helpful to someone, somewhere, in some way. All right. I'm done.